Hello, hello, hello. We're going to get a program going here that I know everyone will want to witness. You know, if you miss it, don't blame me. Okay? I want to welcome everyone to the exhibit. This is the exhibit of Onyx Fine Arts. We've been around for 12 years. And this particular exhibit, we gave the theme Truth Be Told. You know, everybody understands what that's about. I've had an experience in my life, many I guess, you know, you see that gray hair. So I've had a lot of experiences. I'm one of the artists in this exhibit. And a few years ago, it was suggested that, hey, why don't we invite some poets to come in here and look at our art on the wall, and they can go back and write stuff about it and come back and tell you what they think. Or what they've written. Well, you know, I'm an abstract artist. You know, abstract, nobody knows what I think of my work. People look at it and say, oh my goodness, what is that? Well, I had a poet look at my work, and as she was quoting, what she was feeling and responding to what I had done, I was absolutely floored, because no one had ever expressed that much about my work to me before that I was feeling. How could it be? Well, that poet is in the house. Ms. Minnie Collins did that, and I'll never forget it as long as I live. So, you know, so we're surrounded by poets here today who have walked around and been informed by key pieces of art. And I think today you're going to be mesmerized. You know, and I know the artists that they're here, they're going to be mesmerized by what we hear. And hopefully you will be too. So the process is we're going to name the piece of art. We're going to send a runner out to get that piece of art. And we're going to put it somewhere around here on an easel or hold it. And you guys can see exactly what these poets had in mind. Now, I don't know if they're going to entertain questions or not. Because as we are talking about our art, people ask, well, how did you get there? How did you get this? How could that be this? Well, maybe we can tap into their source of creativity as well. But anyway, originally you probably have seen the fact that a lot of our advertisement had said our exhibit was ending today. Well, it isn't. We've been extended to February 18th. You know, the city says, hey, I'm doing a good job over here, you know. Let's keep this going longer. And the beauty for me is that the longer we extend, the farther the word gets out, and people are coming to see if they are amazed, like I am still. So with no further ado, I think, Loa, are you going to handle this from this point forward?
Thanks, Ernie. Well, I am a member of the African American Writers Alliance, and it is actually how I got introduced to Onyx, whose board I now serve on, is through this event. At the last few closings of Onyx's annual exhibit, they've invited us to come and write poetry. So it's always been a real joy to do that, and to kind of say, okay, how do the arts talk to one another, right? Because we do. So we're going to start off, and I will let each of the poets introduce themselves very briefly. We love words, so brief can be a challenge, but briefly. And then they will read their work to you based on the art in this exhibit. So, here we go.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Gail, and I'm a member of the Writers Alliance. I'm going to talk about, my first poem is about free expression and embracing your own truth. The title of this event is Let the Truth Be Told. The Truth Be Told. So here it is. Birthdays. I just had one, but I'm not done having my fun. No time to nurse my ills, drink cod liver oil, rub on Bengay with all those pills. I want to strut like aged wine all the way to 99. Because age is only a number and an attitude of the mind. And to make it real, it's really just how you feel. But let the truth be told, I don't have time to get home.
That's right.
I have much to do and people to see. God saved my life and he made me free. If I want to wear my hair short, long, or in between, or color it black, red, or maybe even green, it could be weaved, whipped up high with streaks of gold. All I want is the truth to be told. I don't have time for getting home. And I told my grandson before he was two, call me Nana. No grandma would do. So get up, bust a move, rise up and fly, and express yourself. Don't just sit there worrying and waiting to die. Make life count and come alive. Move with grace as the years go by. Strut your step, let the truth be told, because you don't have time for getting old.
That's right.
And this whole art expression is about being free, being expressive, not finding yourself in anyone's box. Okay? Be who you are.
With the purple lipstick.
Stick at everything. Okay, my next poem. This is the picture that I'm gonna be. We are gonna be expressing our poetry based on the artwork and the creativity here. So this one right here is about being free, also being free. So it's called, my poem is called Purpose. So God lifted my head, but it came back down. A fake smile on my face always landed in a frown. But sunshine, sunshine, when it came into my life, gave me footing, self-love, and peace without strife. So my mind opened up. Through God's great light, I became empowered, enlightened, with high hopes in sight. To love is to allow myself to live and to be free, to stretch out my limbs and allow real love to increase in me. So I cannot be captivated in a sound made by human hands, shaped by human minds, and strapped down with iron bands. Because who am I? I am undoubtedly a five-walking wonder, a work in progress, though. Shaking up things, making my own thunder. So I'm calling on men and women, yellow, red, black, white, and brown. Hold on to your power and refuse to lose your breath. The queen and the king sure enough wants to come out. Take a stand, give a shout, let them know what you are all about. because you are significant, outstanding, stunning, and fine. Stand up, my brothers, sisters, and let your light shine. Okay? Accentuate yourselves. Don't just go with the flow. Go with the knowledge that you only know. Use the potential that you have within and believe that you were created to win. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Miss Lola?
Who's next?
Who's next?
Go on. Go on. Go for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay. Don't wait for me. Y'all just do it.
Thank you. That's what you're
saying. That's a freaking.
I'm the runner that they mentioned earlier. And I'm doing the best I can.
But you found that one.
I found this one.
Great. Hi. Good afternoon. My name is Margaret Barry, I'm part of the African American Writers Alliance, and I'm going to read a poem that Tracy Poindexter Canton painted called Grow Where You're Planted. Is she in the house today, this artist? Her, when I came a few weeks ago, this one really popped out at me. I was born here in Washington State too in the late 40s, so I really like what she did with this, and so here we go. Bare root and foot loose. My family, mother, father, and two sets of aunts and uncles migrated to Washington State. They planted here and grew. My seed was planted here. In the rainforest, even so, a deforested rainforest. And the roots went everywhere, the store, the beach, and to the downtown theater. And the rain nourished the roots with spirit and resiliency. And the trunk of a maple raised the leaves above the ground for light. And the budding leaves on the evergreen grew out into the neighborhoods, connecting communities. And the apple sapling went to school with purpose and resistance. And the azalea stems blooms into wonderful flowers of rebirth and love. And the madrona branches grew into adulthood with strength, flexibility, and toughness. And the lilac shoots grew into relationships with commitment. And the forsythia wand poofed into elderhood with a sharpness of intellect and recall. And all that growth on the main trunk planted the ability for all of us to respond creatively. Thank you.
So we need the fisher boy. We need the young man fishing.
I'm doing the best I can.
Good afternoon. It's an honor to have you and to be here with you and to share this poem with you. I am actually a science fiction writer. My name is Helen Carter/Meow. And I write science fiction, trilogies, novels, and magical realism. But today I'm going to share with you
poem about a boy. And it's called When a Boy Becomes a Man. The young boy waiting anxiously at the river's edge. The morning sun smiled down on him. The breeze moving through the trees warms him. The leaves on the trees wave down to welcome him. His pole lay against him as he looks between the cattails and wonders if what he has come for will still be waiting when he is gone.
Can I get a copy of that?
I brought you a copy.
This is my piece.
Well, welcome again, and thanks so much to the Onyx Collective, as well as all who are visiting today. You honor us with your attendance and participation. When I first saw this piece, it reminded me a part of my Southern heritage, which is in Virginia. But when I talked to the artist, Ashley Reed, he said it was in Kentucky. So I said, okay, is that right, Ashley?
That's right.
Okay, he said that his parents or grandparents took him to Kentucky. I said, wow, that's just like me. When I would go home to Virginia to see my grandmother. And we would go out in the woods and the trees and get mosquitoes and all those things. So I call this one Kentucky Time. Morning sun slices the mist and the fog to welcome a cathedral of Kentucky tulip trees, outflowering each other for Mother's Nature's First Prize Award. Trees reflected in the Kentucky River are storytellers, keepers of jewels of light from youth to adulthood and through ancestral trees. The waterways map their ways through known and unknown currents, inlets and tributaries, sculpting rocks, youth, stones and pebbles into gemstones for future treasures. The waters in Kentucky connecting also the heart and the water, which becomes the aorta of our lives, creating havens for renewed inner peace, hope, salvation, providing us with nourishment and much needed oxygen. Although the child seems to have gone fishing, it is more than for catfish. He's gone fishing for all of the cathedrals in the air that are symbolized in the Cathedral of Trees to provide symbolical opportunities for the next generation, as well as to map and cross the danger waters aiming for the height of those towering cathedrals. Thank you.
My name is Georgia McDade, and I was at the first meeting of the African American Writers Alliance, and this month is our 25th year. And we will be reading at Elliott Bay on February 25th at 7 o'clock. So please show up and tell other folks to show up. The first poem I read is called The Washerwoman. And if you've been here a while, you've probably seen that you'll never forget that exhibit. And I understand at least three of us have written about it. So I get to read mine first. My grandmother was a washerwoman. And my very first memory, is of playing under a quilt that my grandmother and my mother and aunt were making. I must have been four, maybe five, but probably four. And I don't think about my grandmother too often, but as soon as I saw Carletta's work, I thought about her and I wrote this poem. Up very early. My grandmother, Mama, always rose before I did. Never in my life did I see her sleeping. By the time I was up, she had a big black pot full of boiling water over a roaring fire. Some days earlier, she had used that same big black pot to make lye soap. All she had to do was wait until her clients brought their dirty clothes. Like clockwork, the Hennekers showed up each Sunday night with two bundles of clothes. Mama got the clothes out of the trunk of their car, took them straight to the backyard where she sorted them, and then slowly dropped them in the big black pot the next morning. A while later, she took a long stick and poked the clothes mercilessly. How she knew when they were clean, I never knew. Eventually, she removed them from the pot, put them in a tub for rinsing. She then moved them to another tub filled with bluing. She wrung the clothes, hung them on the clothes line. By late Monday afternoon, she had taken the clothes from the line, folded some pieces, and ironed other pieces. Again, I was warned not to get too close to the stove, nor the hot, heavy irons heated from the stove. By the time the Hennekers returned, their clothes were ready. They paid her. Mama had no complaints about the discomfort. Mama had no complaints about the dirty, smelly work. Mama had no complaints about the strenuous work. This was her life. I wish I had known to ask of what she dreamed. Learn what she had endured. Years later, I realized Mama was but one more of the many who willingly, silently sacrificed so that her children and grandchildren could have a better life. She was one more example of the great love, rare, if ever mentioned, but always so very obvious. She was one more reason for each of us to give our best.
My name is Jay, and as soon as I saw that piece, I went through the entire museum. As soon as I saw that piece and saw that little girl scribbling on that board, it touched me. And so this is the poem that I wrote in response to that. And they are complaining. So, hung on the line to dry. Hung on the line to dry. Bred to bend over a bucket to wash, scrub, rub, ground in dirt out of soil clothing. Nasty linen creased in the horrible screams up in that room. When she is gone to town. Bred to be beaten down for wishing more for ourselves, thinking too highly, acting too sassy, talking too long, looking too hard. Eyes dull, the film of fatigue glazed, staring blankly into a future hung on the line to dry. Hunchback, stooped hands, callous, rough to the touch. Thoughts floating, coding, stagnant water, moving slowly like clouds without the swift winds of hope. Too tired too tired for his I need somebody to make me feel human touch. Too tired for more babies to hang on the line to dry. No giddy up stick horses, red wagons, porcelain white dolls, or bouncy balls from the Sears catalog, or frilly petticoats, listening to a nanny singing, ring around the roses, twinkle, twinkle, little star, rock-a-bye baby, Mary had a little lamb, only a broke down, decrepit London bridge of whips, sticks, and insults falling on our heads, landing on our backs. Children playing, washerwoman in the pail, rub-a-dub-dub, tender hands sliding into the tub of lie, seeing their tears, hearing their muffled cries as their joy, hangs on the line to dry. A harsh, cruel, and different life rotting the roots of my soul. No drums from home beating a steady, soothing beat. No hips of women rocking, necks, arms, drapes, and bees swaying, jumping in unison and rhythm. Only the repetitious sounds of the scrubboard squeezing, rubbing, scrubbing, single, solitary, sad, lonely sound. Tattered clothing, tattered lies, tattered hopes hung on the line to dry. But we heard. Somebody read, and we heard of a man raw, open stripes, hair of wool, black, dark as night, from a far, far, far away land, way across the sea. Clothespins made of metal, not wood. He too was hung on the line to dry. Thank you.
What piece?
Letter from Onyx.
Okay.
How many of you know Mel Brooks?
Oh, fabulous. Wonderful audience.
Because you do know Mel Brooks. Bell Hooks inspired me.
Move your head up on the, there you go.
Okay, thank you. Bell Hooks was the inspiration for my poem or letter based upon Carletta's.
He's here.
Yes, thank you. I call this one The Laundress Writes Back. Okay. Letter from a Laundress. Exploring the oppositional gaze. A term from Bell Hooks. Dear artist, in 3 second flashes, his story. H-I-S-T-S-T-O-R-Y, and sepia prints from a male gaze profile me, number me, date me, and they are weapons to imprison me in pastoral life-size images of women's work. Dear artists, I'm backbent. I have clenched shoulders. I have live and blueing soft hands. I'm wringing and squeezing and flat ironing. To pass the time, I nod and hum the washboard blues and peer into the distance, eyes askance. While humming those washboard blues, I relive and recall the rising waters across those stone blue toxic Atlantics, Pacifics, rain soaked, listless limp bodies rubbing against cut notches in the wooden hull and the smell of the stifling gags of vomit. But in this image or profile, I am dressed for laundry as a laundress. My blouse is tucked in, my buttonholes are perfect, my hair is groomed, and I even occasionally smoke my fragrant pipe and look satisfied. But behind those sepia prints and profiles, we are subjects, not objects. We are not objects of laundry cleaning products that you can now buy on Amazon. I can bilocate, trilocate myself to be in two or three places at one time. Yes, I'm a forerunner of imprisoned domestics, imprisoned by those sepia prints. I think of Aunt Jemima on those pancake boxes, Hattie McDaniels and Gone with the Wind, and the infamous Prissy Butterfly McQueen. All pastoral, romanticized, yet monolithic. Try this image for a change. Just take your arms, your scars, your jackets, whatever you've got there, and wrap around you an oppositional gaze. Look into my third eye, my gaze. I'm Margaret Gardner, who crossed the Ohio River with her children to freedom. You'll see more of that in Toni Morrison's work. More currently, I am Viola Davis in The Help, as well as in Fences. I am most definitely Octavia Spencer in The Help, who baked that salivating, tongue mouth licking, sweet pie for the house lady. Yes. I was one woman who used bluing to remove stains, yellow stains at that, from white clothes to make them whiter. Now how can that be? Now I realize that whiteness is an optical illusion. I'm among women who left these historically blue and red mixed laundries of attitudes and colors and class and religion, because now I need to iron out the confusion in, the confusion from, the confusion around, the confusion outside the big house, the White House. Thank you for your honor. Thank you.
Thank you.
Santiago is coming. I will read this one, Gone Hog Wild on Wall Street. And it's so appropriate for what's been happening these past, 10 days? The title of this one I call A Hog Speaks. You know the one I'm talking about? The Hog Speaks. Oh, he's gonna get it? Okay. You want me to wait?
Yes.
Wait until he gets it?
Yes.
Okay. So Santiago.
Here we go.
I just love this. The moment I saw it. Hog Wild on Wall Street, okay?
Oh, yeah.
Now remember, this is your hog. Wall Street has gone hog wild, you say? Well, I speak for the hogs today. Saying people on Wall Street went hog wild is an insult to hogs. It's like saying blacks are lazy or Native Americans are alcoholics or Jews are stingy. No doubt there are members of these groups about whom such comments are true. But to say the description fits every member of the group is prejudice and definitely not true. Someone somewhere probably saw hogs going wild and the label stuck. A hog would never do what those Wall Street humans did. They lied, they stole, they ruined people's lives. Greed and power were, are their masters, and they are arrogant. Their lifestyles were not the least bit altered as they were crushing the lifestyles of so many who could never have imagined how Wall Street is living. Not one of them lost their life savings, job, house, or had to change colleges or pull a child out of college. And they think nothing of the millions who cannot say the same. And those Wall Streeters didn't go to jail. The Obama administration's Dodd-Frank is supposed to check the activity of these humans. But Donald Trump has labeled Dodd-Frank a disaster and vows to repeal it. Indeed, they committed crimes, but they are above the law. It takes Bernie Sanders to explain exactly what those humans did. It'll be years before we know the true extent of their damage. But remember, it is they, not hogs, who trample people. Yeah. Call this activity what it is. Human wild. Maybe human normal. Once Jesus cast demons from a human into a pig at the demon's request, but those pigs went directly to the lake where they drowned. They didn't hurt anyone. So leave us hogs out of this Wall Street robbery. Please, there's no connection. Wall Street is winning, human wild. Again, I say, maybe the norm for your species. They did not go hog.
First one is grow where you planted. And someone's already done this. The way I saw this was I'm kind of like a diaspora group. So like I imagine it from the point of view that so many of us were transported to so many different places throughout the world during the slave trade. And these are some of the manifestations. A short one, I could have made this home for 3 days long, it wouldn't end, but to make it brief, because they say we talk too much. Here we go. You tried to take our soul, but we gave you your soul. Just like Fred Morton, Jelly Roll, it just wouldn't mean a thing, cause without us there is no swing. Stolen Bodies gave you ska, reggae, and Montego Bay. Stolen Bodies gave you tango down Argentine way. Stolen Bodies brought hip hop. Stolen Bodies developed rock and roll. Stolen Bodies made you stop. Stolen Bodies made you stroll. Come, let's stroll across the floor. Cause Prince said, we ain't gonna fight no more. Cause Stolen Bodies delivered a man named King, who said to the world, let freedom ring. Stolen Bodies delivered the words that do entrance, like the Count of Monte Cristo by Alexandre Dumas in France. And the father of Russian literature is also of the Stolen Ones, Alexander Pushkin, one of Europe's brightest sons. Stolen Bodies in Brazil brought the world's most beautiful martial art, capoeira, with its musicality, acrobatics, grace, and heart. Stolen Bodies in Puerto Rico gave us bomba, gave us plena, via Ismaelito, Cortijo, Curero Lazo, Lo Cepeda, and Roberto Ruena. Stolen Bodies gave us something that most of you didn't know. The beautiful mariachis out of Mexico. Ay, 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 canto con mi alma, porque ese negrito canta con la calma. And Stolen Afro-Mexican Bodies founded the city of L.A. Pio Pico Boulevard bears the name of the first governor's name to this day. And Stolen Bodies designed Philadelphia, Chicago, and D.C. And the hemisphere's first truly post-colonial country, Haiti. Stolen Bodies gave you Fannie Lou Hamer. Stolen Bodies gave you Malcolm X. Stolen Bodies gave you the spices of love. Not that dry-ass missionary sex. Stolen Bodies gave you Julio de Burgos. Stolen Bodies gave you Sojourner Truth. Along with Bob Marley, New Edition, Motown, and Musical Youth. Stolen Bodies gave you blood transfusions and railroad ties. Refrigeration, gas masks, stoplights, cell phones, and sweet potato pies. And, oh, I'm so pretty, but I sting like a bee. Yes, Stolen Bodies with recovered souls have made this entire world a better place to be. I don't know if you got the next one, Ensueño.
It's
Ensueño or any of those pieces. Any of those. So the next one I'm gonna do is Ensueño, or there's a thing that's called, I guess it's called what, synesthesia, where a rare amount of people in this world, like if I'm talking to you, they can actually, depending on the words, they can see colors that go with the words, or numbers are coded with colors and all kinds of stuff like that. And I'm not synesthetic, but I'm kind of weird, so I'm not that far from there. So this poem wasn't that hard to do. One of the poems was entitled Ensueño, and Ensueño in Spanish means in dreams. So I started out in the Dream Park in Spanish, like a few lines, and then since, if I were in New York, this would all be in Spanish. Because I'd be with all the Puerto Rican people, you know? But since I'm here, I'm gonna go like 4 or 5 lines in Spanish, and then go back, go into the English. You know? Then you can get a little bit of beat up. My weird ass mom. Anyway. En sueño que estoy susurrando, alabando y clavando a la vez. En sueño regreso a las travesuras de mi niñez. En sueño te acaricio y experimento otra vez. En sueño me manipulas como una pieza de ajedrez. I was dreaming in ionized kisses traveled from my radioactive heart to your lips. And thunderbolts of white lightning traversed my body from the touch of your honeydew-scented fingertips. In your eyes I gazed the rings of Saturn. In the skies I could see Mars. And in your lilac-scented aura pulsed the pattern of aurora borealistic stars. You held me in opal waves of sound, emanating from honeysuckle flavored teeth, and my licorice-like soul was bound to your cotton candy textured wreath, and the supernova of your heart, illuminated by my cinematic desires of elevating, making love to the epitome of art, perpetuating blackberry flavored fires, and billions of light years away, juniper-like trees cackled at the love we radiated, and in Australia, the playful kangaroos did sway. From the celestial lust that was regurgitated, and the seven-eyed fishes in the deep, deep, deep orange seas of Alpha Centauri stuttered, ha. I'm Johnny Cash. And in Florida, 362-year-old white woman uttered, this is a sticker. Don't try to dash. 360-year-old white gangsters, what's up with the blue? And a glance from her celestial eyes thundered, boy, don't waste your time on them peons, because the universe is about me and you. Thank you, Denise. The last one is going to be a combination. My friend here is being wimpy about it. Is it Marita Divas' pieces? The installations, the big spiritual ones, and I don't know why he can't bring them over here. You know, we need to get him some iron buildings off. And then I'm gonna combine that one with the one that right next to is one where the spirituality of the one that has the seven, and he talks about the drumming back to he thinks of drumming and going back to our spirituality. So this is where these come in. So the burial bow, before I started, the burial bow in Cuba, it was also used in Cuba. They said like in the 1800s, 1900s that they didn't like the kids to play with it because when they played the rhythm, it took their souls away. So I'm gonna start out with that and then we're gonna do the drum part two. And initially what I planned to do was I planned to just come here. I wanted to be in between the pieces and then just actually freestyle, because that's how I create, but that wasn't gonna work. When I did it at home, I realized the only way that would work is if I sang, because I can't do poems over the beat, so we'll have a little break.
Do you want to do that later?
If people are cool with it.
Yeah. Is everybody, yeah. Yeah, why don't we do that later?
Yeah. All right, I'll take a break.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome, thank you. Before I start, I always do this. I always out Georgia because because we got some two or three people I know from UW. She's the first African descent person to get a doctorate in English from UW.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. You know, we need to recognize that. We need to recognize our lifetime, you know. Because like we know this. We were prevented from learning to read. We were prevented from learning to write. There's a big deal about not learning to speak the master's language. And when someone does that, that is something. And we must, I don't embarrass you. We must recognize that, okay?
Yes.
And, Greetings.
Oh, I would say, what a hard act to follow, but it's such a beautiful flow. My name is Imhotep Fatah. I'm a member of the African American Writers Alliance. I'm an artist, I'm a poet. And what I've put together is a tribute to the truth be told artists. All the arts, all the world. First of all, it is an honor for me to share with you, our family, in this sacred celebration of African American cultural creativity that fills us with robust and fundamental liberty. As I behold each creation in the exhibit, I'm expanded, enriched, ennobled, and exalted by the indwelling living spirit of our ancestry. And the living spirit revealed to me that each African American artist is a living African cultural creative legacy. And in their souls, each contain a unique chapter of African creative history. You see, each work of art we behold reactivates ancestral knowledge in our souls. And we hear with our inner ear our ancient noble culture, truth be told. Every artist here that we see has access to their soul's deep, deep creativity. And with this inner vision, their spiritual eyes can see the ancient, the current, the future, power, force, and energy of 360 degrees of regal African cultural creativity. This inner vision also endows and grants the African American artist to be simultaneously the ancient root and the contemporary vital fruit of the African cultural tree of infinite creativity. To be simultaneously the ancient root and the vital contemporary fruit of the African cultural tree of infinite creativity. African American creative family, at this sacred moment of our soul journey through time, let us love and celebrate the enduring union of our souls, hearts, and minds as our creative truth moves with grace across the face of time and with the sacred ancestral creative scepter that we as one now hold. Let us proclaim the infinite peace, power, and love of our ancestral home as truth be told.
All right.
Thank you.
Well, I will read the closing piece. And then what I'm going to do is invite everyone to gather over where Marina's pieces are so that, where did he go? Santiago, right? So that Santiago can then finish his piece. And while he's doing that, we're going to be setting up the Northwest Tap Connection group so that they can do their performance, okay? So go enjoy Santiago's piece and then come on back. So my piece is titled, And So We Gather. Black-eyed peas and cornbread, turkey, mashed potatoes and gravy. Cousin Jerry in the corner, dreaming the diaspora to the future, while Carletta, Clifford, Olivia, Jay, Robert, and Jasmine bring history to life and life to history. Across the room, Arenda blends waves and brings sound into the light, where Brother Paul spins our souls alive from Daddy's jazz and Mama's blues, and Sister Leisha shows us how motion manifests our dreams. Over there, Cousin Ashley, Zorn, Yadessa, Denise, Bonnie, Donald, Lisa, and Marita show off our beauty. Nearby, sisters Esther, Erlene, Anina, Rahel, Anne, with brothers Carlton and Vincent, remind us we are part of something more. While Uncle Ernie, Cousin Jazz, and Brother Omar challenge us to see deeply. We wander from one conversation to the next, picking up a sentence here, a phrase there, a thought this minute, emotion the next. Agreeing and not, laughing and not, learning, teaching, giving, taking, sweet potato pie and red velvet cake. This is Thanksgiving. This is family. This is truth be told. It's on longer to get our gift from Santiago. Thank you. And thanks to all the poets from the Writers Alliance. Thank you very much.